Swords, stone monuments, and nanotechnology. Ancient tech was a lot more advanced and a lot stranger than you might know. Here are some of the craziest ancient inventions scientists still can't explain. Number 11. The calendar of Warren Field. The Scottish team responsible for preserving ancient and historical sites in the region wasn't looking for a historic discovery when they were exploring the grounds of Crothis Castle near Aberdeenshire in 2004. But that's exactly what they found when they discovered some anomalous terrain as they flew overhead. A closer exploration revealed that it wasn't just uneven ground, it was large pits, 12 in fact, arranged in a very precise way as if they meant something. And as the team examined their location, it became clear they had a much deeper meaning. And what they discovered has thrown everyone's understanding of ancient cultures for a loop. The pits aligned along the southeast horizon and seemed to point to a precise topographic point that matches with where the sun rises during the midwinter solstice. This meant that in a very rudimentary way, the people using it could use the location of the pits to gauge the passage of time, and more importantly, the passage of seasons. The earliest calendars known to man were previously believed to be made in Mesopotamia, around 5,000 years ago, but when scientists dated the grounds, they were in for a big shock, because the calendar of Warren Field dates back a whopping 10,000 years. During this time in Scotland, not only weren't there scientists and astronomers, there weren't even villages. The people who used the calendar were most likely hunter-gatherers and nomads who relied on migrating animals for food and pelts. Thus, they had likely used the calendar to predict when in the season they should pass by after plenty of trial and error. What scientists can't explain is how this very early lunar calendar was designed and how the knowledge was passed down to build it. And it's led many to ask, exactly how much did prehistoric people understand that we don't know? But sometimes the biggest mysteries are the most humble. Number 10. Roman concrete. The buildings of ancient Rome are stunning, tall, detailed, and incredibly durable. Wait, how are they still standing and looking habitable 2,000 years after they were built? Your local school was built just 20 years ago and you're pretty sure raccoons have eaten their way into the walls. Sure, maybe the school cut some corners, but Rome had their own secrets. The concrete used to build their buildings is so strong and durable that even buildings submerged underwater haven't degraded much, and many buildings, like the Pantheon, could be mistaken for a modern masterpiece. And the secret is all in the construction. Roman concrete was mostly similar to the concrete used today, working as a binder that could seal stones and prevent water from leaking in. But there were some key differences. For one thing, it was usually coated with stone or brick, and its components were larger than the sand-like texture of modern concrete. It hardened over time, but unlike today's concrete, cracks didn't form. This was mostly due to the inclusion of pozzolanic ash, an ash from a nearby volcano. Together, it created a waterproof, highly resistant seal that holds up even today, after thousands of years of exposure. So, why aren't we using it today? The problem is scientists know the basic components, but they don't know the secret sauce. It's been 2,000 years, and many chemical compounds have changed. The volcanic ash used isn't available now, and whatever the exact formulation of the Roman concrete was, scientists and architects haven't quite managed to crack it yet. However, because it would be so cost-effective, tests are ongoing to find the next best thing. Tests mixing concrete with coal fly ash are ongoing, and it's believed that this could make buildings last longer and cost less to build. Who knows, maybe they'll keep those raccoons out one of these days. It's not the only technology people would love to have today. Number 9. The Ulfbert Swords. Discovering weapons in Europe dating back 1,000 years isn't rare. It was a bloody place, with constant wars between kings and skirmishes between tribes. But in Northern Europe, archaeologists started noticing something odd. They were discovering ancient swords throughout Scandinavia. They were unusually well preserved and covered with runes and inscriptions, and they also had one major thing in common. Every single one of them was marked with the name Ulfbert. But who the heck is Ulfbert? Historians investigating the swords quickly dated them back to the 9th to 11th centuries and noticed that not all of them seemed to have the same production methods. However, many of them used production methods that weren't common in Europe at the time. One even used a unique type of steel that was typically found in Central Asia, thousands of miles away, which made it all the stranger that they had the same inscription and had found their way to Northern Europe. The name carved in them was of Frankish origin, so scientists believe that they might have come from what's now the Rhineland. But that still left many unanswered questions. Ulfbert swords kept showing up around Europe, mostly in Scandinavia and in the Baltic Sea, and soon there were a grand total of 167. While some were in fragments, all were in good enough condition to be analyzed for their construction and dating, and that didn't give many more answers. The most common solution for the origin of the swords is that the steel might have been looted or traded and was then altered into blades, but that doesn't explain the varying techniques used or who the name belongs to. It could have been a traveling swordsmith who put his marks on the swords he made, or maybe a chieftain with a very big ego who wanted everyone to know the sponsor of the blade who killed them. We know what the swords are for, but this next item is a complete mystery. Number 8. The Festos Disc. The Palace of Festos is one of the most important archaeological sites on the modern-day island of Crete, dating back to the Minoan era. Inside, archaeologists found thousands of items of interest, many that helped illuminate how the people of the era lived, and one item that they couldn't explain at all. It was an ornately decorated clay disc, carefully shaped and covered with hundreds of markings. It was clearly something that whoever carved put an enormous amount of time into, and the odds are that every mark on the disc has a deep, profound meaning. The problem is we have no clue what any of it means. Discovered in 1908 by an Italian archaeologist, it has a total of 242 markings and 45 different signs, all made while the clay was still soft by pressing hieroglyphic stamps into it. It dates back over 2,000 years. And much like the famous Voynich manuscript, it's proven to be completely indecipherable. Some claim it's likely a script reflecting a story, maybe a religious text. Others argue it's more likely an alphabet or a system of symbols reflecting locations or events. But no one's gotten any closer to the clue, because it's the only item of its kind, and no other item with those symbols was found in the palace or anywhere else, which has led some scholars to come up with an alternative theory. Could the Festos disc be a forgery? While some insist that the entire thing might be a wild goose chase, most people who have explored it up close and personal do think it holds up. The clay seems to match with other items from the same time period, and a forgery of this level would be extremely hard. Many of the markings do reflect current things like people walking, tools, ships, and animals, but no one's sure how they work together or what they mean. With no additional context to work off, it seems the Festos disc will be keeping its secrets for a good while longer, unless a codex is waiting somewhere deeper in the island of Crete. Sometimes, few things are more mysterious than the written word. Number 7. The Codex Gigas. Medieval manuscripts are normally short and to the point because before the invention of the printing press, even the smallest text was an effort. The craftsmen would usually work on a single piece of parchment, painstakingly writing words and making illustrations, and even the slightest slip-up could ruin days of work. They were typically crafted by monks who devoted their lives to this challenging task, but nothing was ever found on the level of the Codex Gigas, the largest illuminated manuscript in the world at a whopping 3 feet long, 20 inches wide, and 310 pages. The illustrations are more detailed than the average, and very vivid, and in some places, terrifying. That's earned it the sinister nickname the Devil's Bible. Not just for the distinct portrait of a wide-mouthed reptilian Satan, but for one factor. Most analysts of the text believe it was put together in a relatively short period, faster than a single monk could have done it. The similarity of the illustrations indicate it was likely one hand that crafted it, and that's led to a dark legend about the creation. They say a monk had broken his vows and was about to be put to death, but vowed to create a manuscript that would bring glory to the monastery. When his hand was about to give out, he asked for help from Satan himself, who gave him the energy and vision needed to complete it. After all, how else would he have such a clear picture of the devil? Needless to say, this is probably all medieval lore, but the book is so large and detailed that it likely would have been a lifetime opus for a single monk, and the analysis of the text does not indicate it was crafted over that long. That means it was either a team of monks with an uncanny ability to mimic each other's style, or one monk with the world's strongest work ethic. The Codex survived being taken as spoils of war and even reportedly once survived a fire at the Royal Library in Sweden and injured a bystander when the massive tome was thrown out the window. Kinda puts those book reports you had to do into perspective. It wasn't the only ancient text with a lot of unanswered questions. Number 6. The Sumerian King List. Most artifacts don't go back much further than Sumer, one of the first great kingdoms. Based in what's now Iraq, it was a powerful nation that had many kings, and like other nations, they were proud of their history, proud enough to keep their names on one of the most impressive architectural and artistic feats on the kingdom, the Sumerian King List. This epic work of kingdom's history was carved on clay tablets, and unlike the Festos disc, we know enough about the Sumerian script to be able to decipher it and unlock its many secrets of the kingdom's history. But in some places, the text raises more questions than answers. Many of the kings it mentions are known to be historical figures, others have little record of them beyond the clay tablets. But what makes this list odd is that it isn't limited to historical fact. It contains references to mythological figures like the ancient demigod Gilgamesh, one of the very first fictional or mythological figures ever to have stories written about them. And that's not the only place where it diverges from known history, because the tablet features a story of the Great Flood that sounds suspiciously like the iconic tale of Noah's Ark. What's up with this strange mix of real figures, fictional figures, and tales that cut across cultural lines? There are a number of theories, one being that it might be a mix of fact and fiction akin to how many scientists view the Bible, tales of historical figures and events combined with cultural myths. But how did two societies hundreds of years apart come up with the same story about some great flood wiping away everything that came before, possibly as a symbol of divine wrath? It might be that the Great Flood did come, devastating the region enough to affect multiple kingdoms and have the tale passed down from generation to generation. If there was a greater explanation for it, every society might come up with its own. It's probably the most famous ancient building of all time, except it's in the wrong place. Number 5. The Pyramid of Hellinikon. The Great Pyramid of Giza and other Egyptian pyramids are among the biggest tourist attractions in the world, and everyone knows what they're there for. Ancient, ornate burial grounds for the pharaohs, usually just made to be a little bit bigger than the other guys. Other pyramids around the world are usually known to be temples, but located in the plains of Greece, the remnants of two pyramids stand. They look suspiciously like the Egyptian ones, have the same basic structure, and enough of the pyramids remain for exploration. There is just one problem. No one has any clue what it was meant for. The most well-known of these pyramids, the Pyramid of Hellinikon, was initially assumed to be a tomb like its neighbors. But you know what they say about assuming. No bodies were found inside, nor any alternative pieces of evidence like cremation urns. If this was a resting place for a very important person, all evidence of them was long gone. Also surprising, there were no references to the massive structures in any major Greek texts. A similar building was mentioned in a text by Pausanias as a mass grave for soldiers who died during a particularly pitched battle, but that structure is gone and evidence of the larger pyramid's purpose is long gone, and the search for answers continues. The pyramid was first fully excavated in 1937, and the archaeologists exploring raised the possibility that it might have served as a heavily fortified guardhouse for soldiers to keep watch. The only foreign objects found inside were shards of ceramics and lamps, which might indicate that the place was occupied by living beings rather than deceased ones. However, a lot of debate remains over the dating of the pyramids and ultimately their purpose. These pyramids were much smaller than the Egyptian counterparts, but maybe even more mysterious. But no archaeological site puzzled scientists like the one in Bolivia. Number 4. Tiwanaku and Pumapunku. Stonehenge, Easter Island. The world's full of ancient sites that seem to be made out of stones far too large to be transported by humans with no mechanical help. Some might have been assembled by pulley systems and a lot of elbow grease, but the 1,500-year-old site in rural Bolivia is on another level. Not only is the ancient construction made out of massive carved stones that weigh hundreds of tons each, but the stones seem to be extremely even and polished and don't display any telltale chisel marks that would represent the humble method of construction at the time. And that's not the only strange thing about it. Located at the edge of a lake in the Bolivian Andes, these sites are believed to be sacred locations for the Inca people, with those following the traditional faith holding it as the location where the world began. The massive structures are far more advanced than those found in other Inca buildings, leading scientists to believe that they might have had help from other local cultures in pre-colonial South America. A close relationship with the local Wari tribe, who had more advanced architecture, may have made the difference. But that still doesn't answer the question, how the heck was this massive temple built? The largest of the temple stone blocks is around 131 tons, with hundreds of these multi-ton building blocks being placed in shape. While the site has degraded significantly since it was built and access today is strictly controlled to avoid any more damage to the structure, those allowed access have found ornate carvings on the buildings and statues of gods and mythological figures are found throughout the site. While scientists can speculate on how the massive structure was put together, those responsible have taken their secrets with them into the annals of history. But this next site seemed to defy the laws of physics. Number 3. The Oracle Room of Hal Saflaini. The Maltese temple building culture was among the most impressive in the ancient world, with them building massive structures over 5,000 years ago that still have impressive remnants today. Serving as a sanctuary and a necropolis, the Hypogeum of Hal Saflaini has been fascinating archaeologists since it was rediscovered in 1902. The early days of the excavation were chaotic, with workers throwing out artifacts and remains to avoid construction on a new housing process being derailed. But it was eventually discovered, and what was left turned out to be one of the most impressive finds in archaeological history. but it was one room in the building that continues to fascinate and confuse. Constructed in three levels, entirely underground, the upper level contained many rooms for burial or residence. The lower level seemed to be a grain storage facility. However, the middle room was the most ornately decorated and seems to be a massive religious facility. One room, named the Oracle Room, was the smallest of the four and had a heavily painted ceiling. It wasn't until people entered the room and discussed their findings that they realized what made it so unique. Because the second they opened their mouth, the words were projected across the temple. The Oracle Room has a unique property of magnifying and producing a powerful acoustic boost for any sound made within it. It's believed that this was a way to spread prayers or holy text to everyone within the massive facility. But how was this actually achieved? Perhaps it was just a quirk of the construction, or maybe the ancient Maltese designers actually understood the science of acoustics far better than people thousands of years later. The chamber's only explored carefully to avoid causing further damage, and don't speak too loudly or you might hear a rumble. This next invention has home decor specialists everywhere green with envy. Or is it red? Number 2. The Lycurgus Cup. It sounds like something out of Harry Potter, a glass chalice that appears to be red in color. But when you tilt it the other way, it suddenly transforms and is a bright, comforting shade of green. But it's not a magical artifact, it's a real cup, dating back to the 4th century Roman Empire. And it was one of the most puzzling ancient artifacts ever discovered. This kind of optical illusion is hard to pull off even today. So how did Roman designers manage to pull it off thousands of years ago? The secret is something that is thought not just to be far beyond the Romans, but a tool of the future. The cup's magic trick isn't the only impressive thing about it. The glass carvings on it are incredibly detailed and focus on a bloody battle of the mythical king Lycurgus. But the secret of the glass isn't obvious, it's buried deep inside. The crafting of the glass has multiple levels and starts with the traditional Roman glass. But it has a secret. Mixed into the formula is a tiny portion of silver and an even more minuscule percentage of gold. They combine together into an alloy, and that creates an effect that changes the color of the glass as it reflects light. It sounds simple, but not so much. Analyzing the glass gave away the secret. So why can't anyone recreate it with today's glass? If designers had their way, there'd be a modern Lycurgus cup on every kitchen table next to the bobbleheads. There have been many attempts, and a 3D printed material came the closest, but the exact proportion and makeup of the glass was incredibly hard to recreate, and the Lycurgus cup remains one of the most fascinating artifacts of the ancient world. But no ancient technology has captivated the world like this one. Number 1. The Antikythera Mechanism. The year was 1901, and a group of divers near the Greek island of Antikythera discovered an ancient shipwreck. They hoped to find treasure, but they found something else entirely. It looked like a collection of heavily degraded trash, but upon cleaning it, it became clear that it wasn't just scrap metal. It was a carefully designed machine full of massive gears, although it had obviously been degraded due to all the time spent underwater. It belonged to a large machine, but it was from an era where massive machines shouldn't exist. What was the strange secret that the divers had just discovered? The device, nicknamed the Antikythera Mechanism, had long since fallen apart, so the bigger question was, what the heck was it? Multiple components of the machine were removed from the shipwreck, and scientists went to work on what was essentially the most high-stakes jigsaw puzzle of all time. Some theorized it was an astronomical clock, but others said it didn't make sense for the time period. Options for recreating the device were limited in the early 1900s, so it went to storage for decades. But as time marched on, so did answers. It would be almost 70 years later when scientists created an X-ray and gamma-ray image of the 82 broken fragments. And from that came a theory. The Antikythera Mechanism may have been the world's first computer. It used over 3 dozen gears to follow the movements of the moon, sun, and predict eclipses, and mirror the orbit of the moon to help ships in navigating. At least that's the best guess. And this strangely advanced technology dates back to over 2,000 years ago. So that raises the question, what other advanced technologies were created by the ancient Greeks and are lurking in shipwrecks deep below? Want to know more secrets about the ancient world? Check out Scientists Finally Crack Stonehenge Mystery, or watch this video instead.